Paul Wellings. I started off on the local press just outside London, and then I sold stories to Sounds Music Paper, and then I went on to the NME. But I mean, I got involved in the NME in 1974 as a kid when I bought this. It was called Monty Python's Tiny Black Round Thing. It was in the NME in 1974. And I basically saw it in the shop and I thought, well, I love Monty Python. It was the thing at school. So I read that. I bought it purely for this freebie. And as a result of that, I became quite politicised by the writers in there. There were some very political writers in the NME at the time. It was like a lifeline to me. It was like a diary of my life. You know, I just to read this stuff over and over again, and I thought, you know, this is what music's all about. This is what music writing's all about. And you know, say, because it linked up with so many radical movements like Rock Against Racism at the time, it opened up a whole new world to people like me, you know, who, you know, just like music purely as a passion, but then I realised there was a whole set of ideas behind it, and you know, taught me about stuff I didn't know anything about, like sexism, racism, homophobia, you know, trade union rights, socialism.
Culture gave you a big push?
Yeah, culture gave me a massive push. I mean, you know, without reading the NME and linking, you know, and liking someone like Tony Parsons so much at the time and his writing, you know, I'd never have got the break I got, you know, because obviously I interviewed him and, you know, he got me a job in the NME, etc. But, you know, it was a massive, you know, it still is. I mean, my main passions in life are still music, you know, films, books, and, you know, the whole portrait of the artist as a consumer thing that the NME used to do. Every cool artist at the time was interviewed with this thing called Portrait of the Artist as a Consumer. We'd list their favourite clubs, and you got a real picture of who that person was and what made them tick. And you know, whenever I see friends now, the first thing I do is I go and look at their bookshelves and their record shelves and their film shelves, and it gives me an idea of the sort of person they are, you know. Well, the radical music press really was the NME. I say Sounds was mainly for sort of heads down, no nonsense, you know, heavy metal fans. Melody Maker was very sort of middle of the road, but the only one that put its head on the block really politically was the NME. I mean, Tony Parsons and Julie Burchell were the punk writers. They wrote a brilliant book called The Boy Looked at Johnny, which was called The Obituary of Rock and Roll. And they said you know, they weren't here to praise rock music, they were here to bury it. And they fought on the streets at Lewisham against the fascists, got involved very heavily in the Rock Against Racism campaign. Exmoor, one of the writers who I knew there, he was in a band called the Redskins, which was a very big socialist punk soul band. And he went on the Right to Work March, wrote a massive feature about that, about his time on the Right to Work March. And all the writers that I connected with there were people like, was a guy called John Opposition, who was also known as Attila the Stockbroker, which he was a socialist poet. And I was reviewing him, and he was reviewing my band, the Anti-Social Workers. We had a band that we met up with a reggae producer called the Mad Professor, who went on to work with Massive Attack. And our band were involved in lots of benefit gigs, you know, on the miners' strike, say the dockers' strike, the printers' strike, which I was involved directly in. And also he got us gigs with people like Peter Tosh, Bob Marley's partner, and Eka Mouse, sort of big reggae legends. But all of us writers, there was another guy called Stephen Wells, who was also known as Seething Wells, he was a socialist poet. And we'd all be reviewing and writing about each other. So when one of us had a single out or an album out, we'd all be writing about each other. And it was that unity, strength idea that we're all helping each other out. And it was a bit like socialist nepotism, if it's such a thing.
You mentioned in that era, a lot of the writers were involved as band members in their own right, poets. In terms of where the modern NME has gone since, do you feel like there's less of that now? Like, do you think there's potentially a disconnect between the music press and music, for example?
Yeah, very much so. I felt I left the NME in the late 80s, and after that I felt it dumbed down every year. It seemed to turn into smash hits. It became like a, just like a brand. It became just like, you know, it was like selling toothpaste or something. Whereas to me, I was in an era when music really mattered and politics really mattered. I mean, we went through, say, the biggest political upheavals in the 80s, you know, the whole anti-Thatcher campaign that we were involved in. And now, sadly, the NME is being given away as a freebie at Topshop. So it's become a corporate sellout, and I just think it's just so sad that, that it's gone that way.
Obviously, there is a preconception regarding the print media, particularly, and to an extent also now digital media, that people vote with their wallets or they vote with their clicks. And if the views, as for example, if the readership has dried up for NME, people would argue that there's not a demand for a radical press anymore. So you do see a future for a radical musical press, for example.
People, there is a cliche that people get more right wing as they get older. I've found the exact opposite with me. The older I get, the more left wing I get. And you know, now with this huge surge of interest in Jeremy Corbyn, this whole Corbyn mania thing, I feel that there's real hope over despair again. I really believe that, and I feel that this movement that we're getting at the moment reminds me so much of my time on the NME in the 80s, when a lot of young people were getting engaged in politics for the first time. And there's lots of musicians, you know, who're supporting Corbyn. You know, people like Eno, you know, from Roxy Music, and worked with people like David Bowie. You know, he's saying his daughter's got involved in politics for the first time. Damon Albarn is coming on board the Corbyn campaign. And you can guarantee that if Corbyn becomes Labour leader, you're going to get loads of musicians behind him, from Love Music, Hate Racism, a lot of the grime artists like Loki, Akela, Lethal Bizzle, people like that, are going to be supporting someone like Corbyn, Miss Dynamite. And I think when you get someone like Corbyn becoming a Labour leader, and those ideas about anti-austerity and getting rid of Trident and building decent homes and taxing the rich, and these, you know, really, I think, are common sense ideas, I think then you will get a resurgence in a radical music press, because you need to reflect those ideas. I mean, I think social media is really exciting. You know, a lot of the big movements that have happened have come through social media. I think print media is dying, sadly. You know, all the paper circulations are falling, and that includes, you know, the Nationals. And I think, you know, internet broadcasting is really interesting. I just feel that we're living in really, really exciting times, and the tide is turning, and it's, you know, these new ideas are getting out there, you know.
So things can only get better.
I'm not going to use a new Labour catchphrase.
No. I appreciate that.